mercy and forgiveness. Very, very challenging for us. So I certainly do, for those of you that are visiting, by the way, I'm Father Barry, very pastor. Welcome. Glad to have you with us. So now, at this time, as we've done the previous two nights, we're going to ask you, as we welcome Sister Miriam, we're going to ask that you stand and join us in a song of praise.
invite all of you to take a deep breath. Stand up tall. Let it all the way out. Just take a deep breath. One more. All the way in. Just all the way out. Let's just come before the Lord tonight. And once again, offer Him our hearts. Offer Him very honestly whatever is on your heart tonight. Whether it's joy, whether it's sorrow, whether it's anxiety, whether it's excitement. Let's just offer to Him right now whatever is on our hearts this evening. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Lord, we come before you this evening with grateful hearts. We come before you this evening on the eve of a great season where you will lead us and pursue us and convert us. And we just surrender this entire Lenten season to you. We surrender everything that we have in our hearts, every anticipation, every expectation. We just surrender it all to you. Father, I thank you for this time with these wonderful children of yours. And I pray that you would bless them. I pray that this would be a season of miracles in their life, of new healings in families, new areas of forgiveness, and new rivers of hope to be born in their lives. And I pray, Father, that they would encounter you as beloved sons and daughters in whom you delight. I ask you, Jesus, that you would call us all to a deep conversion, that we would turn away from old ways and turn toward you. And I just ask you, Holy Spirit, that you would surprise us this season. That you would surprise us in new and glorious ways, in the big moments and the small moments, and open our hearts to your beauty, to your anointing. And Mother Mary, we come before you again this evening, and we just willingly surrender everything to you. We pray that you would very tenderly lead us and guide us, speak truth and beauty to us this season. And we commend our hearts to you in this time this evening as we pray. Hail Mary,
full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and in the hour of our death. Amen.
Our Lady of Victory,
pray for us.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
My mother has a distinct pride of being part of a German family that is on record the largest family in the state of Texas. And so she, every 2 years, she'll come back to Texas for a family reunion. And it is not uncommon at all to have over 2,000 people at this family reunion. And my mom said when I was younger, it used to be even much bigger, like 5,000 people would come. And all the German descendants came from like one family, and they would kind of all, you know, just compare where they came from and drink beer and wear Lederhosen and that's but a couple summers ago, I was at one of our family reunions, which was much smaller, and my cousin came up to me, and my cousin said, God obviously speaks to me through five-year-old girls. My cousin said to me, my daughter is 5 years old, and she's decided she wants to become a nun. So can she ask me a few questions? And I said, sure, you know, why not? So he takes her hand, and they're coming across the yard from me, and she is sizing me up from about 50 yards out. Can I just say that? Like, and I can tell she's a smart, sassy little thing. I'm like, you should be a great nun. So she's approaching me, and we sit down, and she lets me, thank you very much. She lets me know right away that I'm being interviewed. This is what's happening right now. So I was like, oh, it's fine. So I sit down, and she's so darn cute. Such a smart girl. And she looks at me. Her first question to the nun is, do you play games in the convent? Like games. I said, well, yeah, you know, sometimes we play games, watch the Seahawks lose miserably, but that's the end of the story. You know, all kinds of stuff. So I was kind of telling her what we do, and then I don't think she believed me because she got very specific and she said, what kind of board games do you have? And I was like, oh, this girl's busting me. So I'm like thinking of the board games in our closet that are gathering dust, you know, I'm fumbling here. And then she looks at me and she says, what is nun school like? I was like, nun school? I was like, that's a great name for it. And so I was telling people, well, you know, nun school is where we go. We learn about Jesus, and we learn how to serve people, how to love people, and you know, tell people about the Lord. And she's growing impatient as I'm talking, and I can tell her five-year-old patience is about to run out on me. And finally, she cannot take it anymore. She just flat out interrupts me, and she says, yeah, but do you have time for coloring? Lord, I have no idea what you're doing with your life right now, you know? And I, just at that moment, I just wanted to put my little hands on her face, and I thought to myself, have you ever, let me ask you this, as parents or grandparents, have you ever colored with a child?
Oh, yeah.
Do you know what that's like? Oh, my gosh. When you color with a child, because for them, you know, like I said, we ran a daycare for a long time, and I have spent hours and hours coloring with children. And there's something, like we talked about last night, what happens in our hearts when our hearts are open like a child. When a child is coloring, they lose all sense of time, they lose track of time, and all of a sudden they go from just where they are with you in a room coloring to their minds just transcend time, and all of a sudden they're in a faraway land. Okay, when I grow up, I'm going to be a firefighter, I'm going to be Elsa. And then, you know, like they, this is whole just journey, and their hearts are open, and you just look at them, and they're just transcended time, and there's it's a touch of beautiful thing, you know? And I thought, for a kid, coloring, it's first things first, you know? And I was thinking about our life, like, what are first things first in our life? Let's put first things first. Because there's part of everyone, like we talked about the very first night when C.S. Lewis says, you know, if I find in myself a desire, right, which nothing in this world can satisfy, the most probable explanation is I was made for the new world. And so that is always speaking to you and I about first things, right? First things. And so let me tell you, my dear friends, there's always time for coloring, okay? You know what? Actually, when I put on Women's Retreat, this is a true story, but I put on, after that happened with that, my little cousin's daughter, I thought, this is interesting. So when I put on Women's Retreats, we have a Saturday afternoon, like a 2-hour block of time where you can choose to do whatever you want to do, and I have adult coloring books, and I have colored pencils. There is not one colored pencil left. And it's just beautiful to watch because it activates a different side of your brain, you know? So, I don't know, maybe this line, there's time for coloring, just saying. So, here we go. Last night we talked about healing and forgiveness, and this is a quote that I wanted to include last night, but I thought it really sums up our evening together. And this is from Cardinal Ratzinger, the then Cardinal Ratzinger, Pope Benedict, you know as Pope Benedict, in his essay on the Sacred Heart of Jesus. It's called Behold the Pierced One. He says this. He says, Stoic thought, this is so beautiful, Stoic thought regards the heart as that which holds things together and aims at self-preservation. The pierced heart of Jesus has overturned this definition. This heart is not concerned with self-preservation, but with self-surrender. It saves the world by opening itself. This heart, the heart of Christ, saves itself by giving itself away. And how many times in our life, I've been very convinced that many times in my life I would have made a good Stoic. And maybe that's my mom's German upbringing, I don't really know. Maybe it's part of, you know, nurture versus nature, I don't really know. Maybe it's my type A personality. But at some point, you know, you just see yourself and you see your heart hurting and you just say to yourself, just get it together. Just get yourself together and just go on. And our hearts close when we do that. And what Jesus is doing, like we've talked about the last 3 nights, how Jesus is coming to teach us what it means to be human. But he's not Stoic, his heart is deeply moved. Like we talked about the woman that he raised her son from the dead. We talk about people and lepers, like when he heals the lepers. That, you know, if you're, maybe I'm sure you've heard wonderful homilies about this, but if you had leprosy, why it was such a big deal is you were ritually unclean. You couldn't live in the camp with people. You had to live outside the city walls. You were so ostracized that you actually had to shout out unclean when anybody came anywhere near you so that they would not come into your presence and be unclean. And I can just say, I think that in life we have some modern day leprosy. Where in our life we feel unclean. And we keep our distance from people. And we, you know, we engage in technology. Technology is a wonderful thing, but we engage in it. But many times, you know, we're looking at our screens and we're wondering the same thing. Like, man, if anybody knew me, if anybody knew what's happening in my marriage, if anybody knew what's happening in my life, if I told this secret to somebody who loves me, would they still love me? And what Jesus is doing, like we talked about, he's not just healing, he's not fixing people. And so many times in my life, you know, I go to my spiritual director, and certainly mostly, you know, like 12 years ago when I first started this healing journey, and I had like a little list of things that I thought he was fixing in my life. And I had this little list of word of the Lord, and I thought, you know what, Lord, you can fix this and fix this. And I had a list of the sisters I lived with, too. I had some things I thought God might want to fix in their life, too. I'm like, Lord, if you could just fix this, you know, because if they change my life for better, it's called codependency. And so I had this whole list of things. I'm like, Lord, just fix this. If you just fix this, actually, better yet, had you not allowed that to happen in the first place? But since you did, if you could fix it, my life would be a lot better. And so many times my spiritual, I have a wonderful spiritual director, he says to me, Sister Miriam, you are not, and I'm just going to offer this to you tonight, you are not a problem to be fixed. You're a person to be loved. And when I get stuck in areas of my life where I see my brokenness, because you could tell very clearly I'm not perfect. And Jesus comes to me every day like he comes to you, and he speaks love to me, and he speaks beauty and truth, and he calls me in, and he calls me out, and he calls me up. We are on a journey together. And so often I get stuck in my spiritual life, and just think, let's just stop right there, okay? So let's just ask in this pain where you are, this thing that you're struggling with, or this is something that keeps coming up in your life. Let's just stop right now, and we're just going to ask Jesus to reveal where he is, because he's right there. Because his heart is not stoic. His heart is open. And he desires to be with us. We desire that kind of love. And I was giving a talk to, I do a lot of talk to teenagers, and I was giving a talk this summer, and I came across this tweet that came up on my Twitter feed, and it went viral immediately. And it's by a girl who posted this of her mom and dad. And she says, "My parents have been married for 34 years. My mom is in the final stages of young onset dementia. She was diagnosed 5 years ago at the age of 53. My dad cares for her full time. She doesn't always remember his name, but she knows that she is safe with him. And if that's not true love, I don't know what it is." This tweet, as of a few days ago, had over 160,000 retweets. It has over 200,000 likes. And when I looked through this girl's feed, I was just looking through her feed, I was trying to figure out who she was. I looked through her feed, I found out that she posted this, I believe, in April, and a month later, her mom passed away. The reason why, and it was fascinating to read, if you look at the tweet, all the comments, like the comment boxes are amazing, because these are people from all walks of life. And I don't know what they think about the human person, or what they think about marriage, or what they think love is, but every single person that saw this was deeply moved by this. Because here's this woman, doesn't she look like a child? She looks like a child that she's gathered up into her husband's arms, and I just love everything about this because I love his posture as a man. I love when he's looking into the camera of his daughter's phone, and he's just, this is who he is as a man. This is how God made men physically larger, physically bigger, and what they do is they envelop, they wrap, and they protect, and she's curled up on his heart, and he's protecting her, he's keeping her safe. And if you've ever taken care of somebody who's dying, you know, being a caretaker is a difficult. And I guarantee you that what, 34 years ago, if they came to a church like this, and if they made their vows, and they stood at the foot of the altar, and they said, "I am yours, and you are mine forever," which is what happens when you make vows, I guarantee they didn't sign up for this. There's no way they would have known. And there's something so powerful, if I could just, because this is very beautiful, if I could just stop right here and talk about what marriage is, because why marriage is so beautiful, why this icon of this kind of love, when you're broken and when you're sick and when you have nothing to offer, and when society calls you a burden, and why are you still alive? When somebody still sees you and still loves you and still holds you to their heart, why we ache for that? It's because that's how God loves us. This is why a marriage is a sacrament. This is why it's an icon of how God loves us. And this is why as Catholics, this is why we get married in the church. This is why we don't get married outside. We get married in the church because this is literally the meeting place between God and man. Jesus Christ dwells here. And the vows take place at the foot of the altar. Why? Because this is where Christ says, "This is my body given up for you. This is the new and everlasting covenant," because the man and the woman are about to make a covenant with each other, not a contract. A contract is an exchange of goods. So, for example, in Corpus Christi, Texas, a few years ago, we had a hurricane that came and hit Corpus directly, and it damaged some of our convent roofs. So we had to have somebody come and make an estimate on the roof and fix the roof. So what happens? They come onto the convent. They look at the damage on the roof, they make an estimate, they write out how much they think it'll cost, and then they give it to us, we sign it, and we exchange contracts, so we're going to pay you this much, and you're going to come, and you're going to fix our roof, right? So after the workmen come and they fix our roof, we finish, we pay them, and that's done. They're not coming over to hang out next Tuesday for tacos, it'd be totally weird, okay? We finished our contract, we're finished. But a covenant is not like that. A covenant is an exchange of people. This is why God keeps making covenants. He makes a covenant with Adam and Eve. He makes one with Noah, and then he makes one with the Israelites. He's always thinking, I want to be your God. Like, I'm going to be your God, and you're going to be my people. I'm with you. I'm going to be faithful to you. You are flat out unfaithful to me, but I'm still going to be faithful to you because God cannot deny himself. This is why the vows take place here, right? The groom stands here. The priest stands here. The priest stands here literally representing Christ, and marriage is the only sacrament that actually the couple confers on themselves. The priest is a witness, but the man and woman conferred upon one another. The man stands here as in the person of the priest himself as well, as the priest of the house. He's wearing black as a sign that he's going to die so his bride can live. He wears a white shirt as a sign of his purity of heart. So we stand together, a little nervous, right? Waiting for the bride. And she comes in the back, and the symbolism is beautiful. The symbolism that she comes in the back wearing white because she is what St. Paul says, without spot. She's a sign of the church. Without spot, without stain, without wrinkle. And she comes in wearing a white gown as a sign of purity as the church. And while she comes down the aisleway, accompanied by her father, who is a sign of God the Father. The God the Father accompanies the church, the bride. We're the bride. So God the Father accompanies the church, the bride, what? Down the pathway of life, that we're not alone. He comes and he accompanies the bride down the pathway of life, and he gives her to the son, right? And their love, they make a vow, and they say, I am yours and you are mine forever. I will love you and I will honor you in good times and in bad, in sickness and in health, rich or poor, till death do us part. And their love is so powerful that a third person comes to it. Does this sound familiar? It's Trinitarian love. But the beautiful thing about God is human beings break covenants. We make promises and we don't keep it and we're broken. But God never does. And his vow to us, his covenant to us, the new and everlasting covenant, is not till death do us part. It is forever. And that is the kind of container that holds this kind of love. And this is the kind of love that you and I absolutely ache for. And this is, it's a small foretaste. Like when we're loved well like that, it's a small foretaste of how God loves us, because to him, this is always our home. This is where we find home. So he's always calling us to himself because he loves us. So the last couple nights, we've talked about a couple questions. And the first night, I asked you a question of, I'm so sorry, I'm going to change our codes. But the first night, I asked you a question of, where have you come from? What's your story? Right? What are the chapters of your story? Where have you come from? We talked about what came from the heart of God and made the image likeness of God. And last night, we talked about, where are you going? Right? What's the trajectory of your life? Where are you going? What is your pathway? And we talked about how Jesus says in the Gospel of John, chapter 10:10, it is the thief that comes to steal, kill, and destroy. But I came that you might have life and have it to the full. And that is where we're going. So tonight, let me ask you this. I want to ask you the question of, where are you now? Okay. So what is the next step for you? And so for us on this journey of just of learning discipleship, to live authentically, to live as Christ lives, it means that you and I must have a daily encounter with Christ. Because personal conversion is at the heart of a lived relationship. And it converts us so we can see and love how he loves. And it's very interesting, you and I talked about the Garden of Eden last night. We talked about how Adam and Eve fell away. We talked about the quote from the bishop that says, the sin really isn't eating the apple, or from Georgia is the peach, right? So that's not the sin, that's not the first sin. The first sin is the disfigurement of God, where Satan says, God does not love you. And it's from there, you know, it's from our thoughts, my dear friends. This is why St. Paul says, our hearts, our minds must be renewed. Take captive every thought for Christ, because the war is waged right here first. And that is what happens. I mean, we talked about how their lives are shattered, and they put on fig leaves, and they look at each other in dismay. They hold God in kind of skepticism. They hold him at a distance. And what happens after that is that they hide. And it's very beautiful, because that doesn't stop the Lord. The Lord comes to meet them, because it's the breezy time of the day. He comes to walk with them. And see, I can imagine, like, as the Lord approaches them in the garden, where their meeting place is, where the further breezy time of the day walk, they are nowhere to be found. And he asks them this. And I think we have to be very careful when we assign, like, tone of language to the Lord. Because for some of us, it can be very accusatory. But knowing the Father's heart, and he knows what's happened. And so as God does, he's going to start asking questions. And he goes into the garden, and he says to them, where are you? And if I were to ask you that now, this is rhetorical, but if I were to ask you that now, what would you say? You're physically here. Have you ever been physically somewhere, but you're mentally somewhere else? Or where are you in your life along this road? Because see, God wants to engage you right there. And usually our first inclination is to hide. Just to hide. Nothing will fly. Good. I was telling you about the Medina that when I worked at the daycare, I spent a lot of hours. I mean, this is very true. I spent a lot of hours putting Barbie heads back in Barbies, because that's really what I did for most of the time. And so before the daycare was started, I would put all the heads, right, and I would put them on the appropriate bodies. Master Jermaine Fialzio, putting Barbie heads on Barbies, that's what I did. So I'm like, I would put their clothes back on when it was happening here. Anyway, so I just like line all the ladies up and all their heads on the right bar, you know, on the right bodies, and put the toys and be like, okay, girls, you know. And I go back and I go sign it with it at 3:20, you know, I'm like signing it all the kids, like, and there's heads all over the room. I'm like, what's happening? Because I saw a bunch of girls over here and all of a sudden the heads are, there's like limbs ripped off. I'm like, what are you doing? What's happening here? So I go over and all there's heads like all over the floor. I'm like, wow, what's going on? Oh, I don't know, sister. I'm like, well, that's really interesting because you know what? I just spent 20 minutes putting their heads back on. Okay, before they care. And I see now that the heads are no longer on their bodies and something must have happened. I have no idea. Girls scatter, you know what they found. And I'm like, isn't that so true? Isn't that what we do? That we have sin in our life, or we have an error of brokenness in our life, and the first thing we want to do is just hide. So what happens is the Lord comes and he pursues them because he wants to draw them what? Into community. Like Jesus wants to draw them into community. He draws the leper into community. He raises the dead. And he brings them back to community. So what God is doing, he's not coming to say, what are you doing? What are you doing? He's coming to bring them back because he knows what has happened. And he asks, where are you? Oh, we heard you coming in the garden and you were naked, so we hid. Who told you you were naked? Oh, that woman that you put here with me? Yes, that's that was blank. That woman that you put here with me? Yes, she ate from the tree and I ate it. And he asks Eve, what would you do that for? Oh, the serpent tricked me into it, so I ate it. They just pass the block down like we do that, but it's not my fault, it's her fault, and if she would have said that to me, I wouldn't have said that to me. And then and then from that he knows what's going to happen. He knows that our lives are about to be shattered. But in the shattering, here's the beautiful thing. We call it the proto-evangelium. In the shattering, God announces the first sign of redemption. Where he says, I will put enmity between you and the woman, between her offspring and yours. Right? He will strike at your heel. He's going to bruise your head. So from that very beginning, God is going to insert a plan into our brokenness, into our waywardness. And he's going to make a picture complete. He's going to paint a masterpiece out of it. Because what happens many times in our life, maybe you were thinking about this last night as we worked through our forgiveness meditation, and you're looking towards Lent, and you're like, how am I going to do this? Because sometimes, if I can give you an artistic representation of what life feels like, it might feel like this. So when I was in the Atlanta Art Museum, I was in the French Impressionist section, and I came across a bunch of original paintings by Claude Monet. And Claude Monet has a just very interesting style. It's a lot of like little dots and things like that. And when you get really close to one of his paintings, it's kind of hard to see what it is. And I feel like this is what life feels like sometimes. You know, you're kind of looking at your life and you see some kind of lumpy parts here. And the paint is kind of dry here. And maybe here's some of your blue, purple, sorrowful mysteries that you have a little bit of an inclination of, but you're not really sure. And then every now and then we kind of see a thread of our life running down our life, so we can see patterns. And maybe these are things like, I think I mentioned to you that my father passed away, and you know, I can look now after 18 years after my father passing away and the things that have happened since then, and I can kind of see, even though to this day I miss my dad, but I can kind of see like what God was doing in the midst of even taking my dad home to heaven much earlier than we wanted him to go home. But I think life kind of feels like that. And so if we don't have a correct interpretation of life, this is why I'm talking about where do we come from and where we're going. Because if I don't know where I came from, if I don't know that I came from God, and I don't know that I'm going back to God, this is what life kind of looks like. It looks like a big mess. And what society says this is all there is. And God doesn't love you, God's holding up on you. It's the same voice that we heard over and over again because we don't understand. Because see, my dear friends, this is not the full story. This is just a small part of this. This is a painting called Autumn River Sun by Claude Monet. This, right here, is this. This is you. This is your life. And God is painting a glorious masterpiece in it. And so we get settled so often, we get stuck in our small stories, but we don't understand that this is the path of humanity, this is what God is doing. And even more so, you could say that each dot is like a little member of society. You and I are so interwoven, we're so close together, we're so knitted closely together. I mean, just the fact of who we are one to another, that every single person in your life, God has gifted to you. There is no such thing as a random person in your life. God has gifted every single person to you. I remember one time I was complaining to the priest that mentored me to the Olivet site. I was complaining to him about somebody that I lived with. I'm sure you would have done that. And I was telling him about my sister that I know was a new religious, like, God bless that man. And I was kind of yammering on about this person. I'm like, you know what? She gets on my nerves. Blah. Poor father. Finally, he just kind of listened to me, and he's a very patient, very good spiritual father. And he looks at me and says, Sister Miriam, don't reject the gift because you don't like the wrapping paper. Okay? And I thought to myself, how many times in life do we reject the gift because we don't like the wrapping paper? And we don't understand this is actually what God is about in our life. He's about painting a glorious masterpiece. And if you know anything about art or sculpture, you know that this is not built. Like that very famous saying, Rome is not built in a day. But this takes time. And there's light parts and there's dark parts and there's, you know, there's all parts of the masterpiece. And so that's the beautiful thing about being a human being, is that he calls us into the glorious freedom, like St. Paul says, like the Holy Father's letter for Lent this year, into the glorious freedom of the children of God. And this is the dawn of our hope. I want to talk a bit about hope, if I could, because it's very important when we talk about just, you know, who we are as people, because hope is not wishful thinking, okay? So hope, and I'm just going to give you a definition of hope. Hope is what? The confident desire of obtaining a future good. This is great. This is a straight definition. That is difficult to obtain. It is therefore a desire which implies seeking and pursuing some future good that is not possessed but wanted, unlike fear that shrinks from a future evil. Hope is confident that what is desired will certainly be attained. It is the opposite of despair, so great, it's an act of the will, like we talked about, forgiveness and love is an act of the will. As a virtue, it's a theological virtue, I'm going to unpack this for you. Heaven is our home, God will fulfill his promises, and it responds to the aspiration for happiness which God places in the heart of every man. In the Confessions, the Ignatius Confessions, which is one of the most widely read books in the world, in chapter 10, St. Augustine says this, absolutely all of us want to be happy. Absolutely all of us want to be happy. Every single person wants to be happy. You and I even. This is why Satan presents sin to us under the guise of happiness. It's because he knows most of us will not choose an outright evil. But he presents it as a happiness. You and I are ordered toward happiness. Why? Because we're ordered toward heaven. We're ordered toward God himself. This is where we're going. And so when we're baptized, we talked about how in baptism we're made into God's children, beloved, delighted in. And so we go into Lent, it says delighted children, like who he loves is his children. In your baptism, infused in you are three theological virtues, faith, hope, and love. And theological virtues are virtues ordered toward God himself. Hope is the confident expectation that God will fulfill his promises to you, that heaven is our home. This is not the end. That no matter what is happening in your life, what has happened in your life, or what will happen in your life, that is not the end of your story. The best is yet to come. Why do you think fairy tales in the Western world always end with what? And they lived everywhere. That's the Christian worldview. That's what we want. If you've ever read stories like, I love the Chronicles of Narnia. I love Narnia. That is one of the best series ever written. C.S. Lewis wrote that for his goddaughter. And at the very beginning of the book, he writes, and it took him 10 years to write the series of 7 books. At the very beginning of the series, he says, one day you'll be old enough for fairy tales again. It's a story of the character. It was this lion, you know, who landed in Aslan. And my mother used to read to me, and she would pull me up in this kind of big cinnamon-colored chair. My mom would read to me for hours and hours and hours as a little girl. But she never read to me the Chronicles of Narnia. And about 6 or 7 years ago, Amazon had them all on sale for 99 cents. I'm like, what girl could be a sale like that? You know, so I bought every single book in the series, all 7, and I started at the beginning, and I read to myself. That was like my bedtime story. I read to the Chronicles of Narnia. And many times when Aslan, the Christ figure, was a lion in the story, many times when he would show up in all these unexpected situations, and he would act in ways that are very unexpected. And he would redeem people, he would call people out, he would tell them the truth, he would repair what was lost, he would bring the isolated into communion. And I found myself reading these passages and I would just weep. And not like a weep from here, but a weep from here. And I was like, something's very wrong. And I put the book down. And I put it back up. I read the whole story and I was just captivated by it. And one day I was listening to a lecture by Dr. Peter Craig. If you know Dr. Peter Craig, he's a wonderful Catholic philosopher. He was talking about C.S. Lewis, and he dropped this line that I always remember. He said, and this is his opinion, but he says, in his opinion, he believes that in all of literature, which is a sweeping statement, but he says in all of literature, he believes that the character of Aslan is probably most like Jesus Christ. And it made sense to me. Because you know how that story ends? I'm just going to explore the whole thing. You know how Bodhisattva ends? It's C.S. Lewis, his vision of heaven. And I won't tell you the whole thing, but toward the very end, the very last chapter of the story, the children of Narnia and the creatures of Narnia have a choice whether they want to serve Aslan or not. Because see, C.S. Lewis is not a universalist. Not everybody goes to heaven because it's a choice of free will. Do you want to or not? And some of the creatures in Narnia choose not to. But for those who do, they go into his land, and it's the unicorn that shouts further up and further and further up, and they take off running into this rich land that feels familiar to them, that they've been there before, but they can't quite figure out why, until they finally see Aslan in his native place, face to face. And here's what C.S. Lewis says. He says, "What began to happen after that is so beautiful that I cannot write about it. But what I can tell you is this, that at last, they were beginning chapter one of the real story. For all their adventures in Narnia and all their adventures in this world were only the cover and the title page. And now at last, they were finally beginning the real story, which no one on earth has read, which goes on forever, and in which every chapter is better than the one before." That is where we're going. And so God allows many, many things in our life, right? Many things in our life that don't look like they make sense to us. He allows them because, as St. Augustine said, God would never, ever allow anything to happen in our life that He did not plan to bring a greater good. So He is always speaking to your heart and my heart. He speaks in the areas of kindness. He speaks in the areas of love. And so this is exactly what He's speaking to us in our journey for Lent. Pope Francis, in his letter, he says this, it's very true. He says, when we fail, this is so great, this is like what we were talking about last night. He says, when we fail to live as children of God, we often behave in a destructive way towards our neighbors, other creatures, and ourselves as well. We talked about how we're broken in our relationship with God, with ourselves and others. Since we begin to think more or less consciously that we can use other people as we will, intemperance then takes the upper hand, and we start to live a life that exceeds those limits imposed by our human condition and nature itself. And what happens when we do that is it begins to shatter our humanity, and it leads us into areas of isolation, like we talked about, the areas where we're broken, where we're isolated, and to be isolated is the antithesis of what it means to be human, because God is a family. I remember many years ago I was watching a show, like it was on, I can't remember what network it was on, but it was where they sent a camera crew to maximum security prison, and they just filmed what happens in maximum security prison. And the prisons in America are much better than the prisons overseas. But this is a prison in America, and many things that happen in maximum security prison are so violent they can't even show it to you on TV. They can't do that. But let me ask you this. If you're already in maximum security prison, what is the worst punishment they can possibly inflict upon you, you know? Solitary confinement. For 23 hours a day, I mean, it's hard to even fathom. For 23 hours a day, you are by yourself. And not just by yourself, nobody even looks at you. Nobody looks at you. Nobody touches you. Nobody even acknowledges that you exist. They walk by to make sure you're technically still alive. Nobody cares about you. There's a metal slot under your door, and three times a day they slide a tray under your door of food, and they keep on walking. For 1 hour a day, 1 hour a day, you're let outside to walk the yard. And then you go back to yourself. And if that's what has to happen for some people to curb bad behavior or to make sure that the rest of the prisoners are relatively safe, that's what you have to do. But that is the antithesis of what it means to be human. And they actually interviewed one of the young men, and he was in his early 20s, already in maximum security prison, already in solitary confinement. And as they interviewed, you could just see his rage. He's so angry. You just see his rage coming out. And he says, he's like, I'm all alone for 23 hours, and he's like, nobody talks to me. He's like, I'm here by myself. He's like, I hate it. I hate this. And he can just see his desire, even in his immense brokenness, even in his immense brokenness, his desires tell us a human being for communion. And that's what God is doing in our life. Because Christianity, as you know, please, Christianity is not behavior modification. It is not reform school. We are not here. Jesus Christ did not come to earth and suffer and die for us so you and I can be good little girls and boys. He came and he suffered and died for us that our lives would be completely transformed into glory. Christianity is a complete transformation unto glory. It is you and I living the abundant life. It is you offering our suffering. We're not negating suffering. We're offering our suffering to the Lord where he takes it and he makes it efficacious and fruitful so new life always comes. Our lives will always take on the Paschal mystery of the suffering, death, and resurrection of Christ, and may it always be so until we see him face to face. And so that's what this Lent is all about. So we talked about how the very first night, the invitation that you and I have for Lent is of prayer, fasting, and almsgiving, these three beautiful, beautiful instruments of conversion in our life. So we talked about how prayer heals our relationship with God, how fasting heals our relationship with ourselves, and how almsgiving heals our relationship with others. And many years ago, I was kind of joking about this last time, but many years ago I was watching a comedy show, and it was kind of this evangelical comedian, and he was saying, he's like, are you Catholics? Who's Catholic in the crowd? Let me see, where are you Catholics at? And some of the Catholics go around. He's like, let me get this right. He's like, you got this thing called Lent, right? And they're like, yeah, he's like, so Lent, right? So he's like, let me get this straight. So Jesus Christ, King of Kings, Lord of Lords, Lord of the Universe, he comes to earth and suffers and dies for you, and you guys give up Cheetos. He's like, can somebody explain that to me? Like, I don't understand that. And I was like, amen, brother. Like, unless you have a huge Cheeto addiction, I get that, right? But my dear friends, if we can kind of understand this journey that you and I have been on, that our disciplines, if we want to call them, because discipline and the word disciple is the same real word between student. So the disciplines that we undertake, what happens is our hearts are conformed to Christ and we learn to see and to love as he does. So ideally, ultimately, these are not random things that we do. These are things that are going to lead to our healing and conversion and repentance in life. So for you in life, this Lent, what is the Holy Spirit? Where is he calling you? Because it's going to look different for each of us. But where is he calling you to healing in your area with him, with prayer? What does that look like? And what about areas of fasting? I mean, for some of us, I mean, fasting for food is good. For most of us, you know, it's just easy for us to go to the cupboard and just kind of, you know, eat. Fasting for food is one thing. There's many things we can fast from. But where's that fasting? Like, where's the area of your life where you experience, say, your areas of brokenness with God at? Where do you experience in your life maybe a way you see God as a way of suspicion, a way that you don't trust God? Or maybe prayer for you is just something that you really dread, you don't want to look forward to. Maybe we can just start right there and just have a daily honest conversation with God about who God is. Maybe it is your fasting is something where you seek to numb your heart. Whether that's food, whether that's cell phone, something like that. What is that for you? Just an area of your life where when you feel the pain of that fasting, where you're like, oh, I want to reach for my phone, or oh, I want to reach for some food, or oh, I want to reach for a drink, or oh, I want to reach for gossip, or whatever that is. We all have our story where it actually pains us so we remember why we're doing what we're doing, and we're saying, Lord, come be with me. Come be with me. We're in the area of our life where we're called to give alms, right? We're called to give to others, and we're talking about monetary, but we're also talking about our time. Where do our relationships with others need healing? Where is that? You know, it's very interesting, you know, that when we look at women, women have a gift. You know, John Paul II calls it our feminine genius, and one of the things we have as women is our attentiveness to the other. We're very attentive as women with other people. And we have, you know, what we call intuition, like moms, especially moms have like long-range radar, like y'all have like deep intuition, like you just know. And your husband's like, how do you know? You're like, I just know. Like, I just know. You're right? You just know. And there's something very beautiful about a woman, you know, she's at dinner with her friends and she comes home and is talking to one of her other friends about it. They're like, how was the dinner? Oh, it was great, but something's wrong with Karen. She's like, how do you know? Oh, I know her. That was her favorite restaurant, she got her favorite meal, and she pushed her food around on her plate all night. She was talking and laughing, but I know her. I know something is not right. And if you're really going to, and this is obviously not exclusive to women, but if you really love her, what we're going to do is you're not going to Facebook her, and you're not going to text her. You're going to go to Starbucks, get her favorite $7 drink, okay? You're going to go to her house, and you're going to knock on the door. And you're going to say, how are you? And she's going to say, good, busy. You're like, no, we're not doing that. Tell me how you are. Because I want to love you here. And you're going to put yourself far away. And you're going to sit down and you're going to look at her. And you're going to give her the gift of your heart and your presence. And you're going to listen.
truth spoken to them alone. So what is it, my dear friends, like this Lent, like what is it? Where is the Holy Spirit calling you to invest in relationships with people, to be present? Maybe it's time to write a letter to somebody. You know, this Easter, this does not have to be another holiday in your family where one half of the family doesn't speak to the other half of the family. Because 20 years ago at Thanksgiving, Aunt Sally said something, we're not playing with her kids. We are not doing that, you know. And maybe the only difference in Easter is going to be you. You. Or maybe it's time where you go to somebody and say, you know what, we've had a long history together and I want to tell you that I'm sorry. I'm not like, when you did that, I'm sorry for how I reacted to it. I'm really sorry. And I just want you to know that I'd like to begin again. And I just take full responsibility for my behavior and I'm done with that. I'm releasing you to God and I want to be well. I want our family to be well. I don't know what that is. But do you hear the difference between just random practices versus things that are really investing in our life? And I can promise you, my dear friends, I can promise you that the Holy Spirit will speak to you of these areas because he's speaking to the depths of your heart. In the Catechism, I love this quote from the Catechism. The Catechism 2563 says this. It says, the heart is our hidden center. It's so beautiful. Beyond the grasp of our reason or of others, only the Spirit of God can fathom the human heart and know it fully. The heart is the place of decision deeper than our psychic drives. It is the place of truth where we choose life or death. It is the place of encounter. And because it's image of God, we live in relation. It is the place of covenant, like we talked about covenant. This is where God comes to dwell in us. This is why he will always be about the depths of our heart. He will never be satisfied. I love what Father Ryan was saying at Mass this morning of how, you know, we make our prayers, we say prayers to God that we don't really mean, and then we wonder why he doesn't answer them. And Father Ryan said a great line this morning. He was saying, it's because God's not going to engage with your false self. He's waiting for you to come to him as you are. Because he's there and he wants to speak like any other friend in life. Aren't there people in your life, and those people in mine, aren't there people in your life that you would just love to know better? That you just wish they would open their heart just a little. And you try to be a good friend, you try to make yourself available, but they just are not interested, or they don't feel safe enough. And you have to respect that. You cannot pry the human heart. That's a very sacred place. But doesn't that make your heart ache? There's people in my life that I'm like, man, you're awesome. Like, I just love you. I would love to be a better friend to you. Like, and they have their own story and they're just not interested. And it just breaks my heart. And God is the same way. Like we talked about, he knocks at the door of our hearts and he respects the level at which we allow him to enter. And he's always, always telling us who he is. And he speaks that to the depths. So, this Lent, my dear friends, what does this look like for you? Because I'm going to put on my coach hat here for a second because I've been an athlete for a long time, okay? Because for us to really have a conversion, for us to have something happen, we actually have to put something into the game, you know what I'm saying? So what is this for you? And I would highly recommend that tonight, you know, ask the Holy Spirit in these first few days of Lent, ask the Holy Spirit, where are you healing in your life? What are just choose one thing. Just that's it. Just choose one thing for each and write it down. Either write it down and put it on your phone as a note or tell somebody about it because there's a power of getting it out of ourselves, out to here. Because other than that, it'll just stay within here and then the days will pass by and we'll wonder, you know, what's really happening? This is so great. You know, in his letter for Lent, the Holy Father says this when he talks about these three things. It's so great. He says this. He says, fasting, that is learning to change our attitude towards others and all of creation. This is turning away from the temptation to devour everything, to satisfy our ferocity and being ready to suffer for love, which can fill the emptiness of our hearts. It's so beautiful. So we fast from something, right? Either, I mean, we're fasting things that are bad, but we fast for something that's maybe inherently good. So our hearts are hungry so God can fill it because God is the deepest hunger of our heart. Prayer teaches us to abandon idolatry and the self-sufficiency of our ego and to acknowledge our need of the Lord and his mercy. And this is beautiful. This is almsgiving, whereby we escape from the insanity of hoarding everything for ourselves in the illusory belief that we can secure a future that does not belong to us, right? We could probably have Marie Kondo come to all of our houses, okay, and just help us. Can I just say that? But our founder, way before Marie Kondo, our founder used to say, we're nuns, like, we don't have anything. But he's like, you could probably give away one thing a day and not miss it. You could probably give away one thing every single day for a whole year, and you would probably not miss it. We have so much stuff, you know, and the stuff gets in the way. So, my dear friends, for you, where is God calling you to in these areas?
And make a plan, and you might epically fail on it, but that's okay. You get back up and you try again. This is how our conversion goes, because when we repent, we're talking about repenting from sin, repenting from old ways. In order to have old ways go away, they have to die. And the dying can be a struggle at times. And so the travail of it, the difficulty is not the difficulty. The struggle is never the problem. Actually, struggling is a sentence. Actually, how you build muscle. You go to the weight room, you build muscle by actually struggling with the weight. And your muscles, if you're lifting the appropriate amount of weight, their muscles actually microscopically tear. And then they rebuild themselves, and every time they rebuild themselves, they get stronger. This is why, when we practice disciplines like this, our souls get stronger, our minds get stronger, our bodies get stronger. And like St. Paul said, man, we are warriors. We are about a spiritual battle, and we must be fit warriors. And as Catholics especially, we have everything at our disposal. We have every kind of outcome, we have every kind of virtue, we have every kind of power. The Christ is with us. We have the sacraments, we have the sacrament of confession, we have the sacrament of the Eucharist. We have everything at our disposal to, with Christ, overcome through the suffering, death, and resurrection of Christ. I mean, it's limitless, you know? I was joking one time, I'm like, you know, as Catholics, we have, like, not just regular armor, we've got, like, Navy SEAL Team 6 kind of stuff, you know? But how many of us, and I'm sorry, but you can never unsee this, but how many of us go to battle wearing a Speedo with a squirt gun? You know what I'm saying? Like, we go to battle wearing a Speedo with a squirt gun. We have no idea that as Catholics, we have every kind of armor possibly imaginable. Every single one. So, this is what we're about this month. Can I offer you just very quickly a couple book suggestions? These are two books that I want to offer you, as people often ask me all the time, like, what would you recommend me reading? So I'm just going to, these are just from my own heart. This book, Be Healed, when I talked about wounds last night, and I talked about the anatomy of a wound and the journey of the human person, this is where I got that information. It's by a marriage and family therapist, a Catholic marriage and family therapist named Dr. Bob Schutz. And his book, Be Healed, is the number one book I recommend across the country. Absolutely, the number one book. Hands down, there's not a better book on the journey of the human person, the healing of a human person. I would also recommend this small and beautiful treatise on maintaining, searching for maintaining inner peace. And you can get this, I think, here, the publisher is right here in town. And if you listen to our podcast, Abiding Together, we're actually doing a book study on this. I just want to offer this to you. If you're looking for kind of some spiritual reading or something to read, just to kind of on your journey. But whatever that is for you, okay, so whether that's this or something else that you have in mind for the stages of the cross, you know, wherever we go, I don't know what it is that you need to do, what discipline you need to practice, but Lord have mercy, let's do something. Let's do something. Let's just try. Let's just try and see what happens, okay? Because I think sometimes for some of us, Pope Benedict says this. He says, are we not, perhaps, maybe you're feeling this in your heart right now. He says, are we not perhaps all afraid in some way? If we let Christ enter fully into our lives, if we open ourselves totally to him, are we not afraid that he might take something away from us? Then he says, no. If we let Christ into our lives, we lose nothing, nothing, absolutely nothing of what makes life free and beautiful and great. Only in this friendship, which is a great word, only in this friendship is the great potential of human existence truly revealed. Like we talked about the very first night when Bishop Barron says, the closer that God comes to us, we're not less human, we're not truncated. We are more human, and we become radiant and luminous. If we let Christ, the deepest we can possibly let him into our lives, this night, my dear friends, we will not become less human. We will not become weird. We won't become, you know, kind of a less version of ourselves. You will become the fullness of the person God has called you to be. And what happens when we do this is there's a beautiful gift of gratitude that just bursts forth in our life. Because people that have grateful hearts are people that are open and receptive. People that have grateful hearts live life like this versus like this. And it's so easy to live life grasping and controlling and manipulative. But what God is calling us to, and this was the disposition of Adam and Eve in the garden, and I really feel like this is our whole spiritual journey, of Christ coming so close to us that we have enough trust to once again live our hearts with open hands. Our hands with open hands, our hearts with open. This is what God does. I'm going to show you this little video, if I could, about this very thing. And they're going to ask a whole bunch of people just one question. And I think you might find yourself in some of the people as you listen to kind of what they're being asked. But I would like to invite you as you're listening to it to maybe figure out what you would say if somebody asked you this question. So.
We want to ask you one question. If you can be any age, what age would you be? That's a curveball. That's a pretty good question.
I think
17.
16.
Well, when I'm older, I get to have a sweet 16 party.
I want to work on a computer.
You finally can drive.
And you get to go to every party you want to visit.
Who doesn't want to be older when you're, you know, 12? After you get over 18, after you get over 21, you stop wishing you were older and start wishing you were perhaps a bit younger.
I'd like to be 15 again.
16? Where? My mom cooks for me every night.
Everything was fun. Talking to girls and pimples, dates.
And not having a shave is great.
You're just kind of finding yourself, but you didn't have to live in the real world by yourself yet.
7 years old, because like you don't have anything to worry about.
Worst thing that happens is you have like blisters on your hands.
The body isn't quite as resilient when you're 44 as it is when you're 24.
As of right now, obviously there's still some things that I wish I could have done better or done differently. So,
yeah.
I wouldn't mind going back to 2. Let's just start all over again.
You know, that's a difficult question, only because I was in a hurry to get through life. Consequently, many of those years are a blur. We don't want to go through life having regrets, and at least for me, you know, my regrets were a result of not being in the moment.
Do you like being your age?
I love being that age.
Even though you might be considered the autumn of our years, just think how beautiful autumn is.
I like to be 5 because I just started school.
I like the freedom that I have now. I have a lot more freedom than I did before.
I've grown a lot. I feel like I'm not dependent on any, like, people, physical things.
So have, like, so many years to really figure yourself out.
There's an authority that comes to saying you're 25 without sounding too old.
You can take chances when you're a little bit more established in life than you can when you're, you know, in your 20s and even into your 30s.
One thing I've learned about life itself.
Take it in.
You're really not missing out on anything.
Embrace everything that you can about your life as it is today.
Interesting to think of. So if I just kind of going to end here, but I just want to ask you again, where are you? Because see, Christ is there, and he's waiting for you. And you're not going into the season alone, whether you might be facing something really serious, you're not going alone. And that he loves you. I would be remiss if I didn't tell you one of the most efficacious thing that you can do this Lent is you can go to the Sacrament of Reconciliation, go to confession. It's very interesting. The word reconciliation, we talked about forgiveness, and I told you last night that forgiveness and reconciliation, I was sharing with my story with you how I may never have a chance to reconcile with the person who wounded me the most, but forgiveness is very different than reconciliation. Forgiveness that you can offer to somebody, whether they're contrite or not, whether they're alive or not, you can choose to release them to God anytime you want. But reconciliation is a very different connotation. It's very interesting, the Latin root of that word is this. So reconciliation, means again. Con means together, with. And chulia in Latin is eyelash. So the actual word means to come together eyelash to eyelash again. This is what happens in the Sacrament of Reconciliation. And if you haven't been in confession in 30, 40, 50 years, you are most welcome. And if you want last week, you're most welcome. But in all the years I've been in counseling, all the years I've been in spiritual direction, all the years I've been in healing prayer, all the work I've done, all the 12-step meetings I've been to, There is nothing, 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 absolutely nothing that will ever replace the sacrament of reconciliation. Because what happens, because the priest is indelibly marked, he becomes Christ, his heart is Christ. And when we come and we speak to him, what happens is the merciful heart of Christ receives us and releases us, absolves of our sins, and God wills to remember them no more. And he's not embarrassed of you. God's not embarrassed of you. And you might be sitting here tonight in the throes of a major addiction or some huge area in your life where you have not been to church. You haven't been to confession. You haven't even been near a church in 20, 30 years. You're most welcome. And maybe it's time. Because when we're outside of that communion, we're living in isolation. God desires you to come home. That's his desire for you this Lent, is to come home to his heart. I'll give Pope Francis the last say here, and Father's going to come and bless us. This is from his letter from Lent. Pope Francis says this. He says, the Lenten period of 40 days spent by the Son of God in the desert of creation had the goal of making it once more that garden of communion with God that it was before the original sin. May our Lent this year be a journey along that same path, bringing the hope of Christ also to creation. Let us not allow this season of grace to pass in vain. Let us ask God to help us set out on a path of true conversion. Let us leave behind our selfishness and our self-absorption and turn to Jesus' past, turn to his Paschal mystery. One of the reasons I'm standing here before you tonight is because a priest came into my life and mentored me. But the other reason I'm standing here before you tonight is because of my mother. And my mother, at one point in my life, when I was a senior in college, had finally had enough of me. She had financially cut me off. She had threatened to disown me. And she told me if I continued on the path I was continuing on, I would not be welcome in their house. I would not be welcome at any family gatherings, that I would be dead to them. And I was like, don't tell me what to do. Don't tell me what I'm going to do, but I do not tell me what to do. And my mother was heartbroken, but she was at her wit's end. My dad was a wonderful, wonderful man, a sweet Southern man. But my dad just did not know what to say to me as a daughter, so he didn't say anything. So could I, on behalf of daughters, talk to dads for just a second? Dads, please, please. We need to hear from you as your daughters. If you don't tell us we're beautiful, if you don't father us, even if you feel horribly inadequate and make you feel like that at times, if you don't tell us who we are, we're going to look for men to do that. We need our fathers and our wives to speak love to us, to speak truth, to speak beauty to us. And I know my dad loved me very much, I know he did, but he just did not know how to say it, so he just didn't. And one week my parents came to visit me in college, and I think it was probably the first time my dad saw firsthand how I was living my life. And he saw how toxic it was. But he didn't say anything to me about it. And my parents went home. And it wasn't until after my father died, it's still, in a sense, a tender part of my heart for me. I've talked to my dad many times about it. It wasn't until after my dad died that I heard the rest of his story. That after I made my vows, my mom came to me. My mom said to me, remember that weekend your dad and I came to see you in college? And I said, yes. She's like, here's what happened. Your dad and I went home that night. And she's like, your dad finally told me how disappointed he was in me. And for my sweet father to finally say something, I knew my dad was in heart. And for my mom like wore the pants in the thong, but for my mom to finally hear my dad say something, my mom, it broke her heart too. And my mom did the last thing she could possibly think of. And that night, mom got out of bed, and in the basement of our house, we had a beautiful statue of our Blessed Mother. And then my mom got on her knees. She gave me away. She said, Mother, she is your daughter now, because there's nothing I can do for her. I can't help her. I can't. She is out of control, and I don't know what to do. And on this day, I give her to you. She is your daughter, Lord. I pray that you would heal her, that you would watch over her, and that you would be her mother, for I give her to you. And at that moment, completely unknown to me, I am 800 miles away in college. I'm an active alcoholic. I'm living with a man. My life is incredibly broken. My mom began to fast and pray that I would become a nun. So watch out, that's the moral of the story.
before I go to bed, I promise you that I will get on my knees and I will entrust every single one of you to our blessed mother. I will entrust your joys and your sorrows, your hopes and your dreams, your marriages, your children, your grandchildren. I will entrust this season of Lent to her. And I promise you that as your sister and that as a spiritual mother, I promise you that I will pray for you every day for the rest of my life. I want you to know that your life matters. And the decisions that you make every day matter. And when you say yes to God in big ways and in small ways, your lives are transformed, and that transformation affects the world. And it is my prayer you have a wonderful, 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 glorious, difficult, surprising, just uplifting Lent. And I pray on Easter Sunday that you rise with Christ, the one who loves you. So Father, I do.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The gift of silence is precisely that it gives us time to move from the ears of our head to the ears of our heart. So I'd just like to take a moment to invite you into the places in your heart that are vibrating right now, and maybe you don't want them to be, or maybe you don't know what it means. Maybe you're feeling things and you don't even have words, you can't even explain it. You don't need to. With a little bow of the head, you let your Father know that you know He knows. God does not exist and then is merciful. He is mercy. He is tenderness. He is love. He is light. And at this time, we let go of Sister Miriam, who's the vessel of Him, for He remains. All of our stories have parts where there's bloody messes and shameful, and that's why Jesus went to the shame of the cross as a bloody mess, to say, even there, I'm open wide for you. On the cross, Jesus' heart is pierced. Open wide to reveal that in the Father's heart there has been a wound of love, a gaping hole of love for you. He can't say it any other way than I know every hair on your head. These 3 days have been your gift to us, Father. Not to be 3 days, but to be a revelation of what your church and your Son always want to be at every moment for us. We thank you that before we've died, we have heard the truth of the church and of the gospel, that we matter, that our hearts are good, but yes, suffering, and yes, needing healing, but they are good. We thank you for your dedication and your fidelity, for you know nothing else but faithfulness to your sons and daughters. Holy Spirit, awaken us here tonight and in this parish, that as the rest of the world is celebrating Mardi Gras, we are celebrating the greatest feast, the feast of your love. Lord, we say yes to you. We say yes. We know it may hurt, and so in places of fear, come with your encouragement and your gift of love so that we're not alone. The places of desire continue to show us the path to fulfillment. In the place of wreckage where we don't even know how to begin, Show us that it begins by moving one stone at a time. God, you have ordained Father Barry and I to send your blessing upon your people. And so we ask that your mercy, your sweetness, and above all the light of the truth that you are love, may descend upon these people tonight. I ask that you bless them, God, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
I invite you to stand and join as we praise God to have our gracious. Let's give Sister Miriam of Carson a round of applause.